with the teaching and learning in the 21st century and developing effective supervisory and field observation skill for education professional. And yes, from today, I'm so glad to have you here with us. Simeo Stemmet will host this workshop for course one and course two. Ladies and gentlemen, I would like to present you the video of the Simeo and Simeo song first.
It's time to open our eyes to a bright and promising future. We'll rise to the call of the times and create a stronger tomorrow.
Let's start to make a difference, teaching everyone to learn through science, health and technology. We will share our expertise. By promoting knowledge and policies, we can build a better world.
Let us take a stand for our visions of hope, making future best for the people to grow in a life filled with happiness and dreams. Here at Simeo, building the future is our legacy.
We'll achieve our goals through a partnership, creating opportunities. By working hand in hand, we can accomplish all our dreams. For a better quality of life is now within our reach.
Let us take a stand for our visions of hope.
Dr. Thira Kiacharan Sethasin. Formerly, I was Senator of the Upper House of the Thai Parliament, Minister of Education for Thailand. Simeo STEM Education was conceived in March 2018, and I could see that the future of education lies in the development of science and technology in keeping with the changes of the world. STEM, standing for science, technology, engineering, and mathematics. But in the real world, they have to be used. They have to be applied to problems of the world. Simeo stands for Southeast Asia Ministers of Education Organizations. So the idea is to work politically, internationally, and collaboratively with other organizations. It is a medium, a platform for things to take place. So if you want to do research, you do research in education, like a leadership institute, to provide leadership for STEM.
The center will inform regional policymakers on how to improve STEM education and provide models of professional development and curriculum that can be implemented across the region.
Now, if you look at the world now, the world is changing very rapidly, as you know. And interestingly, if you look at the vacancies of jobs nowadays, the jobs that are usually unfilled nowadays, jobs related to STEM.
Enhancing the quality of the STEM workforce is another key strategic goal of the center. The center has identified a new program for the region, Career Academies, which has demonstrated significant impact internationally on student motivation and employability.
CMU STEM Ed, trying to work with and help teachers, educators, students in the region to advance in STEM education. The reason that I want it to be regional, that we are stronger together if we work with our neighboring countries. CMU is for ASEAN. By helping other countries and working with more advanced countries, not only in the region, our region as a whole can grow together.
By working in collaboration and creating partnerships, we can strengthen regional school leadership capacity, enhance instructional practices, and cultivate cultures of shared responsibility for student performance in critical thinking and problem-solving skills. And as a consequence, improvements in performance on PISA can be realized. Therefore, CMEO member countries have expressed a common desire to utilize a problem-based learning approach through collaboration on developing STEM learning materials which match regional contexts.
If we care about STEM education in the region, CMEO STEM is a way forward. And then everybody will be a good human being.
Thank you for your attention. And yes, for the CMU STEM at our center director, Tudaf, today she have the conflict on her schedule. She have to handle the advisory board meeting with the Ministry of Education Thailand. So that today she just sent us that she video record for her welcome remark. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me to welcome her speech.
Distinguished speakers, Dr. Deborah Neisser and Dr. Kevin Niamey, distinguished lecturers and participants from university and educational institutions, my good old friends from IPST, my colleagues from CMU STEMED, good morning. It is a great pleasure for me to welcome you all participants and be involved in this significant event, the Pre-Service Teachers Education Workshops. The Southeast Asian Minister of Education Organization Regional Center for STEM Education, or CMU STEMED, is hosting the Pre-Service Teachers Education Workshops because it is our priority under the STEM Capacity Building Program. We will have two distinguished speakers who have long experiences in teacher education with us today. Dr. Deborah Neisser is a distinguished lecturer at the University of Wisconsin-Oshkosh, USA. She specializes in science and human development, particularly differentiation, instructional coaching, and pre-service teacher education. Throughout her academic career, Dr. Neisser co-authored four books, one of which was recognized as a best science book and film and a bestseller in 2014. Dr. Kevin Niamey is an Emeritus Outreach and Community Engagement Director at the Wisconsin Institute for Science Education and Community Engagement at the University of Wisconsin-Madison, USA. He specializes in science and STEM education, professional development, the Next Generation Science Standards, NGSS, and Higher Education Governance USA. There will be two workshops to offer. Workshop 1, Teaching and Learning in the 21st Century and Developing Effective Supervisory and Field Observation Skills for Education Professionals, from October 11 to 13, 2022. This professional development workshop will highlight the most recent research findings that aim to improve the supervisory and the field observation skills for the faculty members who are assigned such duties, field placement, and offering proper and needed oversight for pre-service students are essential to proper preparation of these teachers in training. Workshop 2, Teaching and Learning in the 21st Century and Developing Effective Mentoring Skills for Education Professionals, from October 17 to 21st, 2022. This second professional development workshop will highlight the most recent research findings that will improve the mentoring skills of education professionals. Effective mentoring is critical to providing the teachers who begin their teaching careers with insights into the teaching profession as a whole, and to have them reflect upon and support the development of their teaching skill. Mentoring also serves to provide experienced teacher mentors an opportunity to reflect upon their own teaching practices and to share their teaching experiences with a new colleague. These workshops will be disseminated and shared through our website and social media for other interested participants across Southeast Asia countries. I am delighted that you all can be here to witness and experience another important initiative of SIMEO-STEMED that seeks to develop the capacity of educational personnel and policy makers. These workshops are expected to help the center become a regional research and capacity building center of excellence for STEM education that advocates and supports evidence-based policy and practice in Southeast Asia. Ladies and gentlemen, in the rapidly changing era of today, one of the biggest transformations that the region is facing is the Industrial Revolution 4.0. This offers us exciting possibilities as well as challenges. We have to keep improving ourselves to better serve the region and to achieve our mission and mandate as an organization. As one of the newest SIMEO Center, we have accomplished a lot, but our work is not over yet, as we have just recently begun, and we must continue to develop the region to its fullest potential. Particularly, I would like to express my sincere gratitude to Chevron Corporation and the Government of Thailand for their funding support that has enabled these workshops and other STEM capacity building program to be initiated. Lastly, I thank my team from SIMEO-STEMED for all the preparations for these workshops, as this important event took a significant amount of dedication and hard work behind the scenes. Thank you very much, and I wish everyone a successful and fruitful discussion.
Yes, thank you, Dr. Ponpan Wethayangkun, the Center of Director of the SIMEO-STEMED. And before I give the floor to our speaker, let me introduce you the team from SIMEO-STEMED, please. And yes, first of all, with us here today, Dr. Burin Aswapipop there in the back of the room. Yes, Program Manager, STEM Resource and Capacity Building from SIMEO-STEMED. Another one I would like to introduce to you is Ms. Parin Khan, Project Coordinator. Yes, she is the one who contact you and send you the letter. And also we have with us Ms. Juthamat Misuk, project assistant. Yes, she will also help us in this workshop also. And myself, Orawan C. Bunrueng, STEM education specialist for professional academy and learning resources from Simeo STEMED also. So that if you have any inquiry or you need some information, please contact us. And yes, ladies and gentlemen, without any further ado, I would like to give the floor to our speaker, Dr. Nizer, and also Dr. Kelvin. Yes, the floor is yours. Thank you, sir.
Welcome. I have to get a little bit here first.
So while Deb's miking up, everybody has the QR code. Those of you who just came in, there's QR code here that has all of the handouts, all of the presentations. Please download them. There's a lot of worksheets in there that you will be using. We're hoping you can do your work either on your computer or iPad. If you have an iPhone, you may want to do it on paper. So we'll work that out during the next couple of days here, but please go to the QR Google Drive, which is this page right here. So if you have questions, problems, CC's here to help, I'm here to help, Deb's here to help. We're all here to learn together. And I'm gonna make the dramatic first step here of I'm a very informal person, as is Deb. So I'm taking off my suit coat because we're here to learn. We're not here to impress with our clothes and things. So get comfortable. There's water and coffee outside. We'll take breaks. The restrooms are across Kitty Corner, which is diagonal here. Take care of yourselves during the next couple of days. We'll catch you up if you have to step out for a phone call, whatever. We understand. We've been doing this for a long time, and you guys, you're all very important professional people that have other obligations. So when you're in here, please concentrate and learn, but if you need a break, take it. Well, as I said, we have scheduled breaks, but I'm going to turn it over to my colleague Deb, and she's on.
All right. As Kevin said, very informal. Please ask any questions you have. Raise your hand. There's no question that's not important. So we want to make sure that everybody is on the same page. First of all, is this too loud, too low?
Perfect.
Okay. All right. Then I want to tell you a little bit about this page before I whoa, I walked right into the flowers. I want to tell you a little bit about this. There's two Nope, that's work. Would help if I turned it on. Okay, there's a day one, and then there's gonna be a day one morning. We are in the day one morning. Next week, we are doing full day presentations of what we're doing today. So this is a shortened version of this. There's more activities, more slides, more things. I wanted to give you access to that presentation also, because there's information in there that you may want to look at. There's things that we're going to cover today that we're going to do briefly that is like a couple hour long session in the other one. So we're going to be here, but if you have questions or you want to dig deeper into something, go here. Everybody clear on that? The handouts that are here, we may or may not be using them, but when we're going to end the session, Kevin's going to put them up on the overhead. We call them an Elmo. I don't know what you call them here. But we're going to put it up there and project it, and I'll very briefly tell you what they would be used for. It's things that you may want access to at a later time. For everyone clear on how this is going to work? Well, it's going to run. All right.
Those handouts are in your package.
No. No. There's actually, for morning session, there's no hard copy, because there's not some in the afternoon. The hard copy that you have in there are things we're going to use in the afternoon. Morning session didn't have any hard copy. All right, I'm going to put it up and we're ready to go. I just need to start it. It's fine.
I'm going to try slow down Deb. She talks very fast.
Really fast.
We've been working together 20 years.
Probably.
Maybe.
Uh-huh.
excitement states is when she just gets going. So I will try to remind her to slow down.
I'm very passionate about this content, and I know it well, and I just get rolling.
And Cece's here to help us if we need some translation of concepts. Cece's, how long have we known you now? At least 5, 6, 7 years. She was in Wisconsin for a year. Extremely effective teacher in her hometown up in Northeast. So you'll meet Cece. An equal partner in this endeavor has been very helpful. So thank you for all your work, Cece, as well as the CEO staff. This is an amazing support network that we get to work with.
It is. And Cece will actually do some of the presentation this afternoon. You're going to find her stuff really interesting that she's going to work with technology this afternoon. So with that being said, raise your hand if you need me to slow down. Just go like this, just make a motion, and it reminds me, because I'm well aware I speak really fast. That's why I've taken my mask off. If any of you are extremely concerned, I will put it back on, but I'm just afraid that you're not gonna understand me if I keep my mask on. We're going to talk a little bit about what's gonna happen. We're doing classroom management this morning. We are doing formative assessment this afternoon. Tomorrow morning, we're doing active learning strategies. And tomorrow afternoon, we're doing how to give feedback. All of this is being done under several contexts. One, we're looking at things that your pre-service teachers need to know. Somewhere in your program, these pieces need to be put in. And your education system is very different from our education system. When Cece came, she studied at my university actually for a year. She was amazed. We had her take a full class. It was a 3-credit class in just classroom management. What she took away from it, she's been using at her high school and has taught numerous teachers at her high school these skills. So whether it be it taught in separate class in your curriculum, or it be pieced out and taught in each of your areas. There is absolutely no reason that classroom management can't be taught in a science class, because there are very things specific. How to run a lab, how to set up for cooperative learning, how to set up for note-taking, for research. All of those pieces are part of classroom management. And they can be taught anywhere as long as they're taught within the context of the course. And the teachers are made aware, what we just did was blah, 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 blah. And you're going to need to do that when you have your own classroom. Unless we specifically point it out that they're learning this for a reason, and it's not just because that happens to be how you run your classroom, they don't transfer that skill back. So that's what's going to happen the first 2 days. The third day is on supervision of student teachers. And we're going to learn things that you need to look for. When you're in the classroom, what you should be looking for, observing them. You need to be looking for more than the content. Can they teach the content correctly? That's only one piece. I'm going to show you 8 areas that you need to actually be looking for. Some of it happens before. You need to look at their lesson plan, and we're going to talk about what should be in that lesson plan, what should be in their reflection that they have to do after it. All of these pieces need to happen. Again, going back to if you're teaching strictly computer science or mathematics or science, you still need to put those pieces into it. For instance, if you're going to be doing a lab, you could have your teachers write it up as a lesson plan and then do it. Or you do it, instruct it, and then they, from memory, write a lesson plan that would be applicable to that. But it's important that they use that application. In the US, we do this all the time. I teach science methods, and it's very much about how to write the right lesson plan, how to put cooperative learning in it, how to add assessment in it. All of those pieces have to happen for it to be successful. That's the third day. We're going to talk about those kind of things. I'm going to give you a whole bunch. I think there's 50 forms in that day. You're not going to get them hard copy, but I've collected stuff that I think will be useful for you. And you can just tweak it to what works for your special class or university or how it works. But they're forms as simple as how to track the pre-service teacher around the room. Did they talk to everybody? How to look at questioning? Did they ask higher level questions or were they all just basic questions? We're going to talk about little tricks like telling your pre-service teachers, have their questions ready before they start. Put them on a post-it note right on their leg and they just pull them off as they go. It's too easy to forget those questions if you don't have them written down, if you don't know ahead of time. So it's just little things like that that can take your pre-service teacher from a very basic teacher to an outstanding teacher. I have 13 pre-service teachers right now. I got up this morning, they had a whole bunch of things they had to turn into me yesterday. I got up this morning and it would be evening there to a just wealth of questions because, again, they don't know where they're going with all of this. So it's important that we be supportive. That's the third day. Questions on what we're going to do, or something that I didn't say we're going to do that you came here wanting to hear because I probably could add it in. I probably know something about it. Anything. All right, as we move from topic to topic, when we get to the lunchtime, I'm going to move off from classroom management. If there was something that you really wanted to hear about or know about, tell me. That's your chance. We need to put a chart up for a parking lot.
Okay, quick. I'm going to be interjecting a lot here. Deb asked a question, and she waited. Wait time is extremely important. Giving students, like you even, a chance to think about her question, and did it prompt a question in any of you? I've learned, I teach, give it at least 10 seconds of silence. So you were speeding up a little bit, that was probably 5 seconds, but don't presume that no questions means they don't have any questions. They may just not feel comfortable asking those questions. And wait time. Silence motivates students to fill it with noise, which will be their question. So count to yourself 10 seconds of silence. If I ask a question and want a response, the longer I wait, the more uncomfortable the students get, and the more likely somebody will say, I have a question. And that's what you want as a teacher. A situation where the students feel comfortable asking questions. Deb and I have observed a lot of Thai classrooms. Not enough, because every classroom is different, but we've been in a few schools, very different than American schools. Mm-hmm. We do not use microphones in most American schools, and I think every class we've been into, the teacher uses a microphone to try to talk above the students and the noise they're making. We're learning from you, observing you, but you can learn from what our research in the U.S. about learning tells us about the best situation in a classroom. And again, this was wait time. Don't just ask a question and then move on if nobody immediately responds. Give them time to think. I'm one of those slow processors at time. I need time to respond and think about the question. Oh, I have a question about that. Then I'll respond. It might be 10 seconds later. Be patient in the classroom. Okay.
All right, where I was going with that, and Kevin's correct in with the wait time, is have a parking lot. And that's what we're going to do right now. Because, and it's just as Kevin said, some people are uncomfortable asking that question in front of everyone else. So have a parking lot. We always have a parking lot when we hold. Kevin will put it up. All you do with a parking lot is grab a post-it, write your question on it, stick it on the parking lot. You don't even have to put a name on it. Because then when we come back from lunch, we'll address it. Anything we have, and at the end of the day, anything we haven't addressed, we'll address it again. And we just pull the post-it notes off after we answer them to make sure that we stay intact.
So every table has a supplies kit, pens, post-its. The parking lot will be over here. You can write down your question. If you want to post it immediately, go ahead. If you want to post it at break, do it then. Please do it in English. If it's in time, we'll have CC translate it. Either way, we'll get to the question. So parking lot is this area of, you had a question and you want an answer. We will deliver.
We're going to use that chart, though, so stick it on the wall. All right. Finally ready to get going here, I think. Again, no questions on the content or anybody unclear. That is where we are. That is my Facebook, my Twitter, and during the workshop, if you post anything, post it under Thai Educator, and that'll come to me. I follow that, so I'll see any posts that you have. Or later, if you post a question and link it with Thai Educator, it'll come through to me.
Is the concept of a parking lot useful in the classroom?
Absolutely. Have this place where
I didn't have
you're
that.
Doing an investigation or a unit of study and they have a question that they want answered. Have your students feel comfortable putting up their questions. That way the generation of the knowledge is what they want to learn, not what you're telling them. So yes, parking lot is relevant to any classroom also.
This link right here is really important. And that's why I had you bring up your own presentation so you would have the link. I have built a 16-week course, 4 modules, and each module is what we're going to be doing each day in here. Dr. Barron told me that it will be available as a course after this, but there is a lot of information here, and it's set up by week. So there'll be 4 weeks just on classroom management, and there's a different topic at every week. There is also an assignment. There is a discussion. There is reading and the research behind it, and there are the objectives for it. So it's very thorough, but you will find a wealth of information about what we're doing today. So if you really like some part of today, you like how to write routines, if you go into there's a whole week of work of just on routines. And Semio is going to offer it. I'm not quite sure when or what the timeline is. Dr. Byrne may be able to fill you in more on that before the end of the week, but that link is an important link for you. There'll be one for each session.
Online course.
But it's not the course at the moment, but you have access to all the information. Okay, CC, this isn't gonna, didn't start immediately. Do you wanna just play the video, please? This is Kid President. Are any of you familiar with Kid President? He is very popular in the United States. It's probably 4 or 5 years old now, but worth listening to.
It's time to wake up, people. This one goes out to teachers.
Teachers and students.
It's time to get our learn on. And we got a lot to learn, too.
I don't know it all, but I know a few things.
Science. You hear? You take up space, you matter.
It's just science, man.
Don't be a bully.
Don't even be a bully to the bullies. It just makes more bullies.
We can all be awful sometimes.
We can all also be awesome.
It's time to be more awesome.
And that's what's time for.
History. We got to study it so we don't repeat it.
But if history does repeat itself, then I'm going to name my pet dinosaur Reginald. I just hope he doesn't eat me.
We can't just study history. We got to make history.
And history's made by ordinary people.
Ordinary people like you
and me.
And that guy. The world's greatest thinkers.
Confucius,
Albert Einstein,
Justin Timberlake.
They put their pants on one leg at a time,
just like me.
But I put my pants on one leg at a time while I'm dancing.
You can go by. Yeah.
You're gonna be in the video though. That's a school, and you gotta show up.
You can't just sleep in.
You can't be late.
And you can't just hang out in the bathroom. That's gross.
It's like Walt Whitman said, YOLO. Except he didn't say that,
but you would know that if you would read a book, baby. Seriously, read a book, any book except the vampire ones.
You wanna change the world?
You gotta know about it.
What if Shakespeare didn't go to school? His plays would be even more confusing. To be or not to be? Is that the question?
I don't know what question is. I didn't go to school. Anybody? Help me out here.
I got a question for you. But what are you teaching the world? How to be boring? How to make the world sad?
No!
No, you're not. We're teaching the world what looks like to be awesome.
No matter who you are, somebody's learning from you.
Everybody's a teacher and everybody's a student.
Look for the awesome.
Teachers see things. They see when you're running down the hall. They see when you're passing notes. But they also see the person that we can all become someday. A writer or a speaker or Martin Luther King. Teachers, keep teaching. Students, keep studenting. That's not a word. Sorry about that. Here's to teachers that see the awesome. The homework is this. What do you want to teach the world?
Do it.
Let's make some history together. Because it's simple math.
Together, we're louder.
Those girls are a little too loud.
If their teacher inspires you, let them know.
This is for teachers everywhere. So share it with them.
We gotta make the world awesome.
Somebody's learning from you.
I'm out. Get to learn on.
We're making history. I'm gone.
Awesome.
Keep learning, people.
Full Pancake, subscribe.
And I like his ending. What are you teaching the world? That's really what we're about, is we're trying to teach the world for a future, for a better world. A little bit about Kid President. You didn't seem to know who he was. He was very famous in the U.S., let's say. He started, his brother did all the filming, and he and his brother were just trying to send out positive messages, and they just started putting these out on YouTube. Well, he ended up being really popular. He went on a campaign with President Obama at the time when President Obama, he ended up very famous in the U.S. If you just put in Kid President on YouTube, lots of his videos will come up. He's got it on all different kinds of content. Very positive, very fun things. So you can use it for sure in a lot of your things, but they're fun to watch, fun to do. So, agenda, we've already talked about what we're going to do, so I'm not going to spend any time doing this. But again, something very important, if you should have an agenda for your class or learning objectives or something at the beginning so everybody knows where we're going to go. So you notice that's what I started with. This is where we're starting, this is why we're doing it, and this is where we're ending. Really important for whether it be a 1 hour class or a full day session. People, audience, students have to know where you're going. We're gonna do a pre-assessment. So there are two different colors of post-it notes. Actually, there's multiple because I use colors for different things, but you're going to need yellow post-it notes and blue post-it notes. So open up those packages on your tables right now, those two colors. And I'll give you directions for those colors once we get our questions up here. All right, I have four questions. You're each going to need one blue and one yellow post-it. So each of you need one. And you'll need a pen. I believe there's one in your folder to write with. Again, an important strategy. You begin with a pre-assessment. That's what I'm doing right now. First question, and you're going to listen to my statement. If you agree with the statement, you're going to use the yellow post-it note. If you do not agree with the statement, use the blue post-it note. And you're going to write why you either agree or disagree. So it's right there again. If you're confused, yellow if it's positive. So yes, I agree, and this is why. Or blue if it's negative, I don't agree with this, and this is why. Does everyone understand the directions?
Four statements about classroom management.
First statement, and your post-it is going to go right here. And blue and yellow all up here. You don't have to put your name on it. And don't necessarily pick what your partner picks, because I'm telling you right now, if you have a really good statement for why you don't agree with it and everybody else agrees, you could still be right. It's all on, so I'm making you think about and support your idea. Classroom management and discipline are the same thing.
Agree or disagree?
And why?
And why?
It's important to have the why. When you have your statement written out, come up and stick it on here. Cece. Absolutely. Classroom management and discipline are the same thing. Cece, do you want to say it in Thai?
Sure.
อาจารย์ทุกท่านคะเดี๋ยวเราจะใช้โพสต์อีก2สีคือสีเหลืองแล้วก็สีน้ำเงินนะคะสำหรับคำถามแต่ละข้อซึ่งอาจารย์ก็จะโพสต์ไว้นะคะที่แต่ละด้านค่ะ อยากให้อาจารย์เขียนว่าถ้าเผื่ออย่างเช่นข้อที่1นะคะที่อาจารย์เดฟเพิ่งแจ้งเมื่อสักครู่นะคะข้อที่1บอกว่า classroom management and discipline are the same thing ถ้าอาจารย์เห็นด้วยค่ะถ้าอาจารย์ agree withthe statement นะคะเราใช้โพสต์อิทสีเหลืองแล้วอาจารย์อาจจะเขียนอธิบายมี reason ด้วยว่าทำไมนะคะทำไมเราถึง support sentence นี้ถ้าอาจารย์ไม่เห็นด้วยค่ะ disagree เราใช้สีน้ำเงินนะคะแล้วอาจารย์ก็เขียนเหตุผลโดยที่ไม่ต้องใส่ชื่อค่ะเมื่ออาจารย์ตอบคำถามนี้แล้วเรียบร้อยอาจารย์ก็ติดโพสต์อิทของอาจารย์ได้ที่ป้ายหมายเลขหนึ่งตรงนี้ได้เลยนะคะอาจารย์ท่านใดมีคำถามไหมคะถ้าไม่มีอาจารย์ทำได้เลยค่ะขอบคุณค่ะ
When you are finished, bring it up, stick it on. Doesn't matter the order, just stick them up here. Yes, as soon as they stick them up, we're going to do one. So stick them up, and then we're going to do number two. Yep, as soon as I'm waiting for you, when everybody has their stuck up here, I'm moving on to number two. Don't worry about your color. You can't be wrong. Still waiting for some. Again, don't be concerned about your color. It's, you cannot be wrong. That's why it's pre-assessment only. No consequences. And then you'll each need a blue and a yellow again. Okay. Moving on to question number two. Question number two, same thing. Yellow if positive, blue if negative. Yellow you agree, blue you do not agree. Morning routines work best for elementary age students. Elementary in the United States is grades 1 through 6, or grades 1 through 5, depending on the school district. So morning routines work best for elementary age students. They are not needed for high school students. Oh, you want to know what a morning routine is?
Yeah.
Okay, like I'm in an elementary classroom. My students know every morning they come in the door, they put their folder away, they go to their desk, they take out their silent reading book. That's a morning routine. They do it every single morning they come into the room. So what I'm saying here is that they work best for elementary students. They're not needed for high school students, that you don't have to have a routine for a high school student. You understand the question now? Cece, I'll explain again.
คำถามข้อที่2ค่ะอาจารย์ให้ statement มาว่า morning routine work best for elementary age student they are not needed for high school student สำหรับตัว morning routine นะคะเป็นสิ่งที่นักเรียนจะต้องทำเมื่อเข้ามาในห้องทุกๆเช้าค่ะเป็นเหมือนกิจวัตรประจำวันอย่างเช่นที่อเมริกาเนี่ยเขาจะมีที่เป็นโฟลเดอร์ให้เด็กเอาโฟลเดอร์ไปเก็บตรงนี้นะเขามี silent reading ที่เด็กจะต้องเหมือนว่าเข้ามาในห้องแล้วทำได้เลยอย่างเงี้ยค่ะเป็นสิ่งที่ต้องทำทุกเช้าหรือถ้าอย่างเป็นบ้านเราเราอาจจะมีแบบว่าเด็กเข้ามาแล้วเอาของไปเก็บที่ตรงนี้นะถอดรองเท้าให้เป็นระเบียบหรืออะไรอย่างเงี้ยนะคะ statement นี้ก็เลยถามว่าเอ๊ะจริงๆแล้วเนี่ยตัว morning routine นี้สำคัญเฉพาะกับระดับชั้นประถมหรือเปล่ามัธยมไม่ต้องมีสิ่งนี้อาจารย์เห็นด้วยหรือไม่เห็นด้วยใช้โพสต์อิทสีเหลืองและสีน้ำเงินเช่นเดิมค่ะ
When you are finished, put your post-it note up here. We're about split on this one. As I said before, no wrong answers.That's why we call it pre-assessment.
Number three, up in this corner. Rules should be set for your classroom. Agree or disagree? Rules should be set for your classroom.
สำหรับข้อที่สามนะคะ Rules should be set up forThe classroom ก็คือกฎควรห้องเรียนควรจะมีกฎกติกาหรือไม่นะคะอาจารย์ agree ไหมคะว่าห้องเรียนควรจะมีกฎ
When you have your answer stick it up few more yetFor the rules.
Number four, as Deb said, this is pre-assessment, so this is a topic we're going to cover tomorrow. But we want to know what you know about note-taking. I know how to teach my students the skills of note-taking. Do you agree or disagree?
สำหรับข้อที่สี่นะคะstatement คืออาจารย์ทราบวิธีการที่จะสอนนักศึกษาเกี่ยวกับการจดโน้ตค่ะ
I guess that infers that you believe note taking is important mm-hmm. and that you need to spend time teaching it
ค่ะคืออยากจะทราบว่าอาจารย์เห็นว่าการโน้ตเทคกิ้งการจดโน้ตเนี่ยค่ะสำคัญหรือไม่นะคะ
Thank
could know how to do it, not do it.
Statement ก็คืออาจารย์ทราบว่าจะสอน note taking อย่างไรค่ะถ้าอาจารย์เห็นว่า note taking สำคัญอาจารย์ก็จะ agree กับ statement นี้นะคะ
All right. I'm going to process this out now, and I'm going to process it out differently. First, I'm going to tell you with if you were using it in a classroom and you were really doing this, how you would process it. Then I'm going to process it with you and tell you what I can see just by looking at them and what the color says to me. Okay, if I was doing this in a classroom and how you want to teach your pre-service teachers to use pre-assessment, I would take in the information as the teacher, but I wouldn't share it with the students right now at all. The whole reason to do pre-assessment is to engage their thinking about what they're going to be learning. And so I've engaged you in thinking about some of the things that we're going to learn about in classroom management. That's the key to the pre-assessment. It also tells me as a teacher things that you already know. I know everybody up here is in agreement about the rules statement. Over here, almost everybody is in agreement. Back here, we're half and half. So I want to make sure that I address this somehow during my presentation that day, my work, because it's very, we're on two different sides. So I need to give you information, but after I'm finished giving the information, I give everybody a chance to change their answer. Okay, now we've had the lesson and we've done this. Do you want to change anything? You're yellow, do you want to change to blue? And I give everybody a chance, and we do it all at once, all four questions. They are welcome to go back up and pull down what they put up and put up a new one. Or they can leave it exactly as. That right there then is my formative assessment. I know who has learned the lesson and what I wanted them to take from it. They already know it. Follow? So I can use this as pre-assessment. I can also use it as formative assessment at the end of my learning because I know where they went. I'm not going to take the time to have you think about it and change, but it really helps me even now during the PD because it helps. I'm going to process out the boards right now, and I wouldn't do that otherwise. When we're finished processing them, then we're going to have a break. But the reason I want to do it now is because I want you to be thinking about how you might use this in your own classroom and where something like this can be taught to your pre-service teachers. If they don't experience it and they don't know that it's out there, there's no way they can throw it in. But this for me, the other thing, I can tell immediately. I need to make sure that I address that board back there. I need to make sure I address this board up here because I don't agree with this board over here. So I for sure have to address that because I don't agree with it. Don't agree, and it's because of the language. That's why, and I'll explain that. The word rules up here, and I'm sure it's in how we change the language, that needs to be routines. In the US, rules would not be. You don't write a list of rules because then all you're looking for is behavior to change the, or break the rule. Who breaks the rule? That's if you teach routines, there is no rule breaking because they know what they are expected to do and they stand out immediately if they're not following the rules. So, not following the routine. So, that's why I disagree with that one.
Let me interject on two with routines again. How many of you have routines with your undergraduates? What if the question had been, do you use, are routines important for undergraduate instruction? They absolutely are. Think about a lab that you didn't have a routine of, okay, here's how we get the equipment you need to do this lab. You have a routine to check out. It would be chaos if you didn't have routines. You may not realize it, but you have your routines for undergrads and even graduate students. Because that's the classroom you want to establish.
With the routines here, high school students, absolutely necessary for high school students. It may not be what you're like you asked about a morning routine for elementary, someone that was up here. Yes, for a morning, it would be you put away your stuff, you do this, you go to your desk, you take out your silent reading book. For high school, it would look very different, but you still should have a routine, whether it's they have a homework folder, a place that this goes, you're going to use your computer. What you put on the board in the morning when they get there, and they know to look at the board, this is what I do when I enter the room, and they immediately do that. That gives you time to answer any questions with individual students, to take attendance, if you have to take lunch count. All of those kind of things can happen with no chaos if your students know. It also allows the teacher to stand at the door and greet the students because they don't have to be in there monitoring. A lot happens with that relationship if they're just standing at the doorway meeting every one of you. I tried at the end, too many came in right at once, but you notice I tried to greet every one of you. That's important for the relationship piece. If that teacher is standing at the door greeting every single student that walks through the door, research shows the learning goes up just because that develops a relationship with the students. If they don't have a routine, they don't know what to do when they enter the classroom, that teacher cannot stand at the door and greet each one that comes in. So yes, routines are important at this level. And you determine what that routine is. I'm not saying that everybody has to come in and take out a silent reading book. That is not what it's about. It's about what works in your classroom, because it frees the teacher up to do those things in that first 5 minutes that really are important.
Right now, there's a routine being discussed about these things in the classroom. Which routine is it? Yes, cell phones can be in a student's pocket, or no? If the routine is no, the students know they have to put their cell phone in a bin when they walk in the door. I don't know what the research is going to tell us about these things and what the community wants, but that's part of the routine, is trivial things like, do you allow a cell phone or not? That becomes part of the routine in a high school classroom, even with undergrads. I hope when you do tests, you don't allow cell phones, because all the answers are right here. But if you're having students do research in the classroom, this is an amazing tool. So what is your routine about when cell phones are allowed?
Note-taking. In the full day, we actually teach this, and we have about an hour on it. I'm not probably going to get to it. Kevin and I aren't going to get to it this morning because we've got classroom management too short. First of all, I want a question. Oh, and I haven't even told you. I have prizes for when you answer me. I have all kinds of prizes up here. The most popular one at the last Thai workshop I did are my party beads. If you answer correctly, you can have a party bead. Not correctly, just answer in English. I have some post-it notes. I have some little books. I have party beads. I've got some Dr. Seuss stickers. I've got some fun stuff, so you want to answer me because you could be getting some party beads. So, why do you think I would be teaching note-taking in classroom management? Party beads, all right.
And a microphone.
So you asked me the question, why you have to teach us to do the note taking. I think because if we learn something, right? Different people have the way, different way of understanding things. So that's what I think, like, if you teach us how to do note taking, or I can teach my student to do note taking, so they can, you know, write out what they understand and in their notes. So let's summarize what they understand in their way. So that's
correct.
Absolutely, right. Arm.
Give it to Cece. Anyone else on note taking? Why would I have it with classroom management? Why did I put it here? Woo! Party beads!
Okay, I think it's the good way to let our pre-service students to have a take note, because we want students to organize their thinking between the teaching, and okay, they will be categorized the learning.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Correct? Yes? Any other thoughts? Oh, we got another one that wants some party beads. Okay.
Okay, this your question is where touch my heart. You know, when I have class with my student, they don't take note at all. They just take the camera and grab it. That's why I agree with you on this question. I understand with her answer. Because the student have to grab the idea, they have all the concept. That is their note taking, it's not copy from the board. Mm-hmm. And you know, that is the student understanding. That is most important. Thank you very much.
I agree. I'm going to just, because we need to get ready for break, so I'm going to give you a couple more ideas, and I'm just throwing them out there. We'll stop the discussion. Note-taking, there's multiple ways of teaching notes. I see someone up here put down something about, I'm not sure which way my students learn best. Well, guess what? In the folder, especially the big one, the module I showed you, there is a lot of research on note-taking. There are four or five different strategies and ways of taking notes. Go in and look at it, because it's really helpful for students to learn how to take correct notes. We're going to do some guided notes this afternoon. I believe this afternoon, maybe tomorrow morning. But I've developed, and then we'll do guided notes. We're going to on a jigsaw. We're going to do guided notes on a video you're going to watch. We're going to practice doing those specific kinds of note-taking so that you do that with your students and you encourage your pre-service students to learn how to do it. There's a skill to taking correct notes, and it is more than just taking a picture. You, two-column notes, Cornell notes, are the most common in the United States. They're really, really research-bound. Research shows totally adds to the learning. And I would take it one step further and tell you that you teach your students to color code it. I believe we're going to talk about that tomorrow afternoon, but it may be missed in the shortening, but it is in the materials. Color coding, if it's the same concept, and maybe you talked about it here and you talked about it later, they take a marker and they box in those pieces. So if you were learning about, say giraffes, okay? And you were learning about why their neck is the way it is. Everything about the neck that you talked about throughout the day would be highlighted in red. So they could go back. And you talked about their habitat. Well, then everything about their habitat is highlighted in green. So you teach your students to color code their notes when they're finished. Works two ways. One, it pegs it up in the same spots. So for their brain, it cognitively works because it hangs it on the same peg. Two, it allows them to have to review their notes. If you tell them that you're going to look at their notes to see that they're color-coded the next day, they had to go back and read their notes. You have no way of knowing if they looked at them again unless you do something like that. Very easy situation again. The next day you say, hold up your notes. You don't care if they're color-coded correctly. That's not your job. Your job is to look and see, yep, they did something with their notes because they're color-coded. So a very quick assessment, formative assessment again. You know they reviewed their notes. No extra work for you. A two-minute plan of holding them up.
One quick comment on notes. It's a great opportunity for students to identify what they have misunderstandings or trouble understanding. If they put it in their notes, they can take the note and say, I don't get this, and then they'll figure it out that they need to spend more time on that concept that's in their notes. If they're trained to do that, where they're thinking about their thinking and their lack of understanding, that's the perfect learning situation. That's metacognition. So note-taking can help them be a better thinker about what they're learning.
And
it's break time, right?
Right. Any burning question, though, before? Because even though we did a very simple activity, we've covered a lot of information here. Any questions? 20-minute break.
There's food, drink. Quick. Yep.
Grad students, and we mostly do with the PowerPoint. Okay. and we don't have those, you know, books or sheets, how about the note taking?
Great question about, and my faculty and staff at the university are big on PowerPoints too. How do you do note taking with PowerPoints? It's the same kind of thinking of, you can't copy everything that's up there on the screen, and students need to select the big ideas and fill in the blanks afterwards. And that's a skill. That is a real skill of taking a very complicated PowerPoint slide, because we try to put everything we want on that topic on the slide, and distilling it down to the most important thing to learn. Good question.
I would do guided notes to teach your students how to do it. And guided, when I'm talking about guided notes, you'll see some examples. I've developed them for you for some of the stuff. Guided notes, what you're going to do is you take your whole presentation and you visualize it in steps, okay? First, you put your vocabulary words in, and you'll have two columns. Sometimes, some people do three because they give a third column to draw a little illustration if the student is better with illustrations. Depends on the student. But your guided notes, you have the two columns. List your vocabulary words first, your new vocabulary. And then before you even start your presentation, go down and say, these are the vocabulary words, pronounce them for them. You don't have to tell them anything else about it, but they have to know that they're watching for these words. When one of those words comes up, they put down what it is about that. Then you start in with either topics or categories or things that you want them to note. And you'll just put half a sentence in that, I gotta think about what side I'm on, in the left-hand column. So, and then leave space, however much space, and then they end up, and then they put that information in there. That saves them from trying to really try to decipher your slides and what's most important and what isn't. And it really helps students organize their learning. But guided notes are the way, especially if they're not used to having to do it, or they're not, start with guided notes. So I know some teachers that use guided notes always. They have guided, and they make it up for specific lectures. Well, you can use the same guided notes every time. They either electronically load them on Word or something and they go right in, or they put them on paper. The ones I have for you today are on paper. Questions on guided notes? You'll see once, when we do some, I'll say to you, okay, this is an example of guided notes. That's note taking. Okay? Break.